Some say that humankind evolved out of chance, while some can reiterate the entire evolutionary chain it took to make us the bipedal creatures we are. Whatever the case may be, we are here and we are curious. Rightly so, because so far as we know, we are the only species in existence. The only intelligent life sending out feelers to see what's out there. So, before we move forward and start this journey, we would like you to like and share the video and subscribe to the channel, so that we can keep on bringing exciting things to you. So, let's start. In August 1977, we took a huge step in that direction. NASA launched two space probes, the Voyager 1 and 2. The mission? To give us a glimpse of our neighboring planets and to go out in the deep space so we can figure out what's what. The Voyagers are still on course. Their mission is still ongoing and at the mature age of 44, they have given us more than we had hands to hold. Both spacecrafts had identical systems with different trajectories. Voyager 1 was giving us the close-up of Saturn's rings and its largest moon, Titan. Voyager 2 was sent to do a grand tour of our sister planets. The project was initially built to last for a total of 5 years. 5 years, you read it right. Going from a 5-year mission to a 44-year mission that's still ongoing. The Voyagers have been remarkable in many ways. This is the first in the long list of accomplishments. The Voyager's journey may have started from humble origins, but it has gone galaxy-wide ever since. That it still continues to cruise effortlessly through the darkness and the vacuum is a testament to NASA and the engineers that worked on the Voyager projects. The team is no doubt infinitely proud of what Voyagers have allowed them to learn. Before we begin to understand what kind of discoveries the Voyagers have made, we need to understand just what kind of readings they were designed to pick. Bus housing electronics. The part of the craft that supports the various scientific and engineering systems. Each side of the bus carries various electronic equipment. Bay 1 carries the radio transmitters that allows the Voyagers to send data back to Earth. Cosmic ray subsystem. It sounds like something that measures cosmic rays, but the scientific explanation is a bit more complicated and very detailed. In short, this subsystem is designed to read the cosmic particles surrounding it. The Voyagers are mindful guests and they don't disturb or slow down these supercharged particles. They merely read the area and send data back to us. High gain antenna. The Voyagers send data back to Earth on two frequencies. The first of those at 8.4 GHz and deals with science and the engineering data that we receive. The second frequency at 2.3 GHz sends data regarding the health and present state of the craft. Imaging science subsystem. Possibly the only part we are all excited to know about. So what does Saturn actually look like? Or the rings? Or the moon, Titan? All that data came from the television-type cameras attached to the craft. Infrared interferometer, spectrometer, and radiometer. Don't let the big scientific name fool you. The IRIS is a collection of mundane technical equipment. It's basically a thermometer, used to pick out heat around it. The second function tells us whether the particles are on a surface or in the air. And lastly, it records sunlight reflected by a surface at three frequencies: ultraviolet, visible, and infrared frequencies. Magnetometer. As the name suggests, this equipment is used to measure the magnetic field emitted by the sun and how it changes with time and distance. Additionally, they were engineered to ascertain if the other planets have a magnetic field of their own and how the moons and other celestial bodies react to it. Photopolarimeter subsystem. Again, scientific jargon discourages us, but essentially it's a miniature telescope fitted on the craft. The objective of this telescope is to help us figure out how the physical properties of the matter present on the four giant planets. Now, what did all that fancy equipment allow us to pick? Let's take that in order of equipment described above. As the Voyagers flew by Saturn, they picked up charged particles around its stratosphere. Another such reading came when the Voyager flew in the heliosphere. Perhaps the most remarkable read came from when the CRS data confirmed a space where the solar wind was blowing in no direction. That area is now identified as a space where the solar wind is actively pushed back by the cosmic rays. The universe is beautiful, but brutal. The twin antennas regularly send data updating the scientists on Earth about its condition. Perhaps the most significant data it ever sent was in 1990 when scientists decided to turn off the cameras to conserve power. The reason for that is that there's simply nothing to see out there but darkness. Voyager's biggest and most visual discoveries came in the form of pictures they took. From the highest quality pictures of Jupiter to date, close-up of the red spot, active volcanic activity on its moon Io and its shiny ring, Voyagers had a busy time capturing Jupiter. Around Saturn, the Voyager took high-resolution pictures of its three moons. A false color view, a high-quality picture of its moon Enceladus, along with a montage of the system complete with the moons. Thanks to them, we can also see what Saturn's atmosphere looks like. On Uranus, we saw its outermost ring, its moon Miranda, cloud movement, and time-lapse. The most remarkable discoveries of note were the three new moons discovered. Yet to be named, they are for now called 1986 U1, 1986 U3, 1896 U4. A tenth new ring was discovered, named 1986 U1R. When the Voyager approached Neptune and started capturing shots, we found Neptune's rings, its great dark spot, the patchy surface of its moon Triton, and cloud streaks on the planet's surface. Voyager 2 discovered two new moons at Neptune, named Satellite 1989N2 and Satellite 1989N1, and ice volcanoes on Triton's south pole. As the Voyager flew past Saturn, its iris systems picked up complex organic molecules in its moon Titan's atmosphere. Voyager's magnetometer found that Uranus's magnetic field was found to significantly offset its axis of rotation. Jupiter's rings and moons exist within an intense radiation belt of electrons and ions trapped in the planet's magnetic field. These particles and fields comprise the Jovian magnetosphere. The heavy ions migrate outward and their pressure inflates the Jovian magnetosphere to more than twice its expected size. Some of the more energetic sulfur and oxygen ions fall along the magnetic field into the planet's atmosphere, resulting in auroras. Saturn's magnetic field is found to be weaker than Jupiter's. The existence of a magnetic field at Uranus was not known until Voyager's arrival. The intensity of the field is roughly comparable to that of Earth's. The magnetic field of Neptune, like that of Uranus, turned out to be highly tilted. Voyager's studies of radio emissions caused by the magnetic field revealed the length of a Neptunian day, which is about 16.11 Earth hours. The spacecraft also detected auroras, though they are much weaker than those on Earth and other planets. Voyager's PPS systems picked up a high-resolution profile of the rings of Saturn, Uranus, and Neptune. Voyagers have been the most successful and productive space exploration mission ever undertaken by humankind. The amount of data is staggering, and it may as well take scientists years to decode and make sense of. Some of them are benign facts that we are better off knowing. Others are completely life-changing, and they may shape the future of space exploration from now on. From pictures to statistical and numerical data, there is much to sift through and defer from. As of now, both spacecraft have entered the heliosphere, the region where the Sun's gravitational and magnetic pull ends, and our cozy bubble of radiation and charged plasma clashes with the wild and untamed power of cosmic winds. Voyager recorded a massive temperature spike as it entered that barrier. The next milestone to look forward to is the Oort cloud, the most distant region of our solar system. Said to be home of comets, past its boundary our solar system truly ends and the wild cosmos begins. If the Voyagers continue unhindered on their current trajectory, they are said to reach the Oort cloud in another few hundred years. Well, this is where we say our goodbyes. Thanks for watching, and don't forget to like and share the video and subscribe to the channel. I'll see you in the next one. Until then, peace.